I want to ultimately find out if zoos need to change to serve animals and humans better.
Or if they should be consigned to history.
If you peel it all back and you look at, say, London Zoo in 1828 and all the other zoos throughout the 19th century, they all had big animals, showy animals, colourful animals, mainly from Africa or from Asia. Typical zoo today has got exactly the same collections. They have not moved on from that.
Opened in 1928, Detroit Zoo kept the same animals most other zoos did, including elephants, a star attraction.
This place is taking a long, hard look at the scientific evidence to determine what animals it should keep and what it shouldn't.
This used to be the indoor enclosure for Detroit's two Asian elephants.
Now notice, there is more room for people than there is for elephants.
I didn't want to be smart about it, but how come there's more room for the people?
Because zoos, in the beginning, were thinking a little bit more about people than they were about animals. Many captive elephants have major problems with their feet because they're not walking enough and they're not walking in the right material.
It turned out captive-born female Asian elephants, the majority of the zoo population, were living 19 years on average.
We looked to the nearest thing, which was timber camps in Burma. We found that they were living to their about 40, so at least double what we were seeing in zoos. It really raised a massive red flag that something is not right.
I think this generation of elephants have suffered, and you can see that in the scientific data. We can see it. It's a shame, shame on us. But the next thing is what we're going to do about it. And the next generation needs to be protected. And we learn from the past.
This is stereotypic behaviour. Abnormal and repetitive with no obvious purpose. Professor Mason investigated why animals display this behaviour.
The species most at risk was the polar bear, which has the largest home range of all land mammals, sometimes over 250,000 square kilometres. She challenged zoos to fundamentally improve the way they keep wide-ranging carnivores or phase them out.
That really put the cat amongst the pigeons.
At over 1.6 acres, this enclosure is more than eight times the size of the old one. This enclosure cost around $16 million to design and build. At that kind of price, trying to meet the welfare needs of animals like polar bears forces zoos to make hard choices.
You can't do every animal. You can't have a postage stamp collection and expect to be able to have all the animals thrive.
If the world is beautiful and like it was when I went first to Africa, that's where all chimps should be. And quite honestly, when you go to a really good zoo, which has a big outside enclosure, then you think, well, actually, if I was a chimp, I'd probably rather be here than out in all these dangerous situations in the wild.
Zoos are saying that saving animals is their fundamental role. Around 400 pandas have been bred in captivity. This project is succeeding in breeding animals, but struggling to build a self-sustaining population in the wild. Just five have been released, and only three survive.
All things considered, a huge amount of money has been spent on the captive breeding program for pandas. And considering so few, although precious individuals, have been reintroduced, has it been worth it? Is it worth it?
I mean, we've learned a lot. And should we continue them? Right now, I'm feeling no.
There are a lot of people today who say that zoos should shut down. What do you think?
I think those arguments of zoos being part of the problem and using animals and having massive welfare issues and not educating the public and not doing conservation was true in the 40s, 50s, 60s, and shame on us, probably in the 70s and early 80s as well. But genuinely, in the last 10 or 15 years, the world's changed, and a lot of zoos have woken up to that. And a lot of zoos are run now by people like me who passionately understand this, understand the arguments, and we're trying to make a difference.